Hello, I'm Hugh Bohane, international journalist, zooming in on the Oscars from Vietnam. Today, I'm in conversation with writer Christopher Hampton, acclaimed Vietnamese-American filmmaker Tiana Alexandra-Silliphant, and indie filmmaker and editor Douglas Thompson. Sir Christopher has been nominated for 3 Oscars in the course of his career, and this year, along with Florian Zeller, he is nominated for Best Adapted Screenplay on The Father. So, let's get things rolling. Tiana, can you give us your impressions on the Oscar-nominated films?
Enjoy this, because this is almost like art films unite year, you know, speaking of not just political, but the cultural times. It's about us. It's about how we, you, all of you watching this, we need to support the films that we love. We need to go to the theaters when we can. This, hopefully all this will be behind us, but we need to support.
I might want to get back into it.
Now with the streaming and, you know, this is changing the industry a lot.
All this is all quite healthy, and I my feeling is that as soon as the restrictions lift, people will be really anxious to go back to the cinema in the way that I'm hoping they'll also be very anxious to go back to the theatre. I think people have discovered that they've really missed it.
It seems to be a matter of form in the UK that if you're knighted, you don't boast much about it.
I think in the theatre, people don't tend to use their titles and not in credits, and it's very rare.
We should mention that you have been recently knighted. You are now Sir Christopher, correct?
It's true.
Yes, and the film is starring Sir Anthony Hopkins, and they're all making a big deal of that.
I think he doesn't use the title in his credits.
Anthony, Tony, he likes to call himself, he's so down to earth, and he's another one, formidable and vulnerable, right? Wouldn't you say? That's what he did that made me weep in The Father.
I don't know what she's cooking up against me, but she's cooking something up.
What are you talking about, Dad?
I'm not leaving my flat! I am not leaving my flat! This really is my flat. Isn't it?
Florian Zeller, our dear friend, our dear writer. This is his first screenplay, Christopher,
yep.
Written with you. So Christopher mentored Florian Zeller. You know, the two of them were like best friends. Love each other as human beings, as writers. So it takes that kind of collaboration, you know. But then I want to send a message to Florian. How can he not be nominated for directing The Father?
One of the reasons is the way things have changed lately is that this eccentric thing about the number of best films that are nominated. So there are 8 best films nominated and only 5 directors. So clearly 3 directors are going to be dropped by the wayside. Priorities have changed this year, and there are all kinds of other, you know, kind of political elements coming into play. Long overdue, many would say, and I would agree with them.
Christopher, The Father has in fact been nominated in 6 categories for the Oscars, including production design and best editing. How do you feel your meticulously written screenplay has been amplified by the meticulous set design and editing?
Yes, I was particularly pleased about that. It's a very complicated design job that he did. The colors are changing, the furnishings are changing, the pictures are changing. But the whole film is shot in that suite of rooms. And also the editor, who's a Greek editor, Yorgos Lampimos, who works in Paris.
And he's amazing. He's a big protege of Chris Marker. He lives in Chris Marker's loft in Paris.
Chris Marker.
Christopher, you cast this movie. You rang up your buddy, Tony Hopkins, Sir Anthony. You rang him up, and he played a film for you called The Good Father.
It's extraordinary because, I mean, I've had a very long career now, but to have been working, as I was, at the very same time on the film of The Father and Maggie Smith in A German Life, and to go from one set to another was just a most extraordinary privilege, really.
tell us, you've been so busy on Zooms, you've been on the publicity for your new play. I'm so proud of you.
Well, it's not really, it's actually the 2019 play that Maggie Smith did in London.
Christopher is so modest, I have to introduce A German Life. It was Christopher's idea. They made a film about this very, very elderly lady who was Goebbels' secretary. I was flown to London to see this play. It was only in London because Maggie Smith, whom we love so much, she's in her 80s playing a woman over 100 years old who just tells us in a 90-minute monologue how she was the regular person, a young girl, had a boyfriend who joined the Hitler party, the Hitler youth, and she talked about, oh, well, we just, you know, said hello to the guy up there, and next thing we knew. So she was just so matter-of-fact about the whole thing, seemingly didn't have a clue, didn't know, right, Christopher? Until when did she know that she was working for this monster?
She says that at the end of the war, she was arrested from Goebbels' bunker in Berlin by the Russians, and actually put in Buchenwald camp for 5 years and released in 1950. And she said it was only then she discovered that the man she'd been working for had been, you know, a member of a regime that had killed 6 million Jews. And the problem the play puts to you is, do you believe her or don't you? Can you believe her or, you know, is this possible? And I think that the more I worked on the play and the more I studied her, I kind of began to feel it was possible. And it began to link up in my mind with things that were happening elsewhere in the world now, where people are fervently believing in things which are absolutely not true. The first screenplay I ever had made was a version of Ibsen's A Doll's House. And that was in 1973, and Tony played the husband.
And anyway, you did promise, didn't you?
And I've been about 35, I suppose.
I've heard that he was a rowdy young man back in those days. Do you have any recollections of his character?
Yes, I think he was a rowdy young man. In fact, he shared an apartment, which he describes as a greenhouse, with the actor Victor Henry, who was the star of my first two plays, who died in his 30s of drink, frankly.
I have to be honest with you, I never drank with anyone that could drink like a Welshman. I mean, even Australians can't drink with Welsh people.
Oh, we are the best drinkers. Yeah. We are the best.
Were you a scrapper when you were drinking?
No, I was just morbid and depressed.
Right, yeah.
English actors of his generation, you know, or slightly earlier, so that you talk about Richard Burton or Peter O'Toole or Richard Harris. I mean, there's a whole list of them. Their drug of choice was alcohol.
Someone asked me once, what's the difference between you, say, and Tom Cruise and people like that, when Tom Cruise is a major star, you were a major star? I said, there's a great difference. I said, see a photograph, go back on the old days, and you see me going to one of my premieres. I had a bottle of vodka in my hand. Tom Cruise got a bottle of Evian water. That's the difference.
You know, and it destroyed a lot of people. And Anthony's, in a sense, the sole survivor.
So now he's a painter, right? He prefers being known
as... He paints, he plays, he composes music. He's an artist.
Are you ready for the Oscars? We'll be watching from all over the world.